This is the Weird Things podcast, or at least this is the pre-show for the Weird Things podcast. I'm going to wait for Andrew Main, who will join us live from Anaheim, California, with one Chris Kenner. Hopefully, we should be going live on diamondclub.tv right now. Hopefully, that works. Are we live? Here we go. Cool. So let me text Andrew to tell him. Sent you an invite. I have the wrong mic selected. How is it the wrong mic if that?
Line in. How's that? Any better? Hopefully that should be good. And so we were going to run through Austin, and then I ambitiously thought that I wanted to try and stream it through here since we have the new rig, but we have yet to work out the kinks on Skype. If I'm just streaming shit right from here, everything local in the studio, we're good to go. DCTV 22422. Austin shows chat on the screen, and I show chat on the screen when I am doing everything here. Problem is that Skype is a fucking huge resource hog, and I have yet to figure out how we can figure that out. So we are just waiting for Andrew to join us here on the Hangout, and then we will get ready to go. We're going to be joined. This is going to be a treat. I don't know if he's been on the show in a very long time. I think he was on once, but Chris Kenner is one of the most imaginative and hardworking people I've ever met in my life, and he is going to be a very capable fill-in for Brian, who is, taking hitting him with the bonge to new levels out here in France. He is not going to be a ninny in Paris, but rather a ninny in Cannes. Ace Detects here in the chat. Send it to Chris's Gmail. Okay. I have a Chris Kenner. Okay, so we should be getting Chris Kenner on here, and then we will be ready to roll. It's the thing about technology, man. Like, you got a problem, you get technology to solve it. You're so happy. It is the Zelda, you've got a key moment. And then, almost as fast as you've solved your problem, you realize what the limitations are with the technology you have now. Now, hopefully, the distance between you figuring out how to solve your problem and figuring out what your new problems are long enough for which you can enjoy the technology. But very often it is not. And that's what we have here, because at the end of the day, I think I'm going to have to figure out a way that I can stream. I mean, I'm going to need a two computer solution if I want to encode and do Skype. I mean, basically, it's, you know, building the same machine that between no, Alpha Geek Radio is possible. What channel are we on Alpha Geek Radio? We can't open up the butt. Oh no, we can't. I haven't downloaded butt yet on the new computer. Fart. Yeah, Alpha Geek Radio might not be a possibility. Unless Todd's in the chat room here. Yeah, I need Todd to set up Bud on this computer. Because I have not done that yet. All right. Try to get Chris Kenner and Andrew Main on the phone. Do, 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 do. Chris Kenner. Yeah, I don't think I have a Gmail account. See if this works. Invitation has been posted.
Okay, go ahead.
Hey, there we go.
Hey.
What is up, guys?
Hi.
To be continued. Showing crew a magic trick.
Nice, 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 nice.
Hey, Justin.
It's Crow. Crow over there.
Crow?
Hey, buddy.
All right.
Let me get it.
Okay, guys in the chat room, audio wise, let me know how we're doing. Let me start up Audacity so we can record locally. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Guys, can you talk?
I'm talking out my mouth hole right now.
Hello, hello.
That'd be the ADHD Chris Kenner right next to me.
How much can we curse on this?
None. Bryce has to edit it out. It's a family.
Neshcom wants to edit. That's how much you were allowed to curse.
Yeah.
That's awesome. He looks so distinguished with his gray hair.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm going for. That was the whole plan. that and, you know, hereditary aging.
But you look so young.
I mean, for 22, you don't look too bad.
Yeah, I know. Okay. So I'm trying to balance out the audio a little bit. You guys might have to just talk a little loud.
Hello.
Hey.
Hi.
How you doing?
Okay. Yeah. No. I think we should be all right.
A couple guys in a Disneyland hotel.
Yeah. It's a shocking amount of content that we produce from that we've produced in the last few months from Disneyland hotels. All right. Cool. Well. Go ahead and make sure that you guys speak loud and directly into your computer when you talk, and we'll be good to go. Are you guys ready?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Then I'll take the role of Brian and count you in here.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined with Mr. Justin Robert Young.
Hello.
And filling in for Brian Brushwood is Mr. Chris Kenner. Kenner is a very accomplished magician, show producer, TV, theater, all that other stuff. And he happened to be in L.A. when Brian decided to abandon us. And so, Mr. Kenner.
How's it going? Good to be here.
I think I was trying to remember whether or not you've been on the show before, Chris. And I think
way back. He was in the middle of trying to, his other gig is executive producer, David Copperfield's show. And I think it was like, you know, while the show was going on,
backstage.
Yeah, that's
that would do. Most of my podcasts are backstage.
Did it vanish? Okay, perfect. Check. All right.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Call me. I think you put the duck on the wrong side of the bucket. Yeah, I get that. I get that one.
That is one of my favorite parts of becoming friends with you, Chris, is that like you are very often very on top of very extraordinary things, you know, be it like the Vegas show, you're out in Mushike, you're handling some sort of a wild and crazy big production, but it's never panic. It is always just, I know. I got to make sure that the gold doubloons are buried in the right place, for the big
thing that we would do. That sounds like something that I've done.
So
I've had to bury a treasure on the island many a times.
So I'm glad that you're here, Chris, because I want to start off with a topic about something kind of interesting, eccentric. Right now, the monster at the box office is Jurassic Park World. Jurassic World.
Yeah.
Jurassic Park World or Jurassic World?
Fine. Jurassic World is made over $500 million. It's the fastest movie to ever get to $500 million. It's unstoppable. Inside Out had a very respectful, week the weekend, but
what did it do?
$80 million.
I think more. I think it was just over 90 as projected for Sunday.
I stopped counting to do the podcast.
So. Okay. It's in the U.S.
Yeah. So it's doing great. But Jurassic World is this amazing monster hit. And
you said 500 million and it's 500 million worldwide versus 80 million U.S. Right?
Which question is it? Sorry, Inside Out for this week.
Jurassic World made over 110 million domestic in its second week opening.
Second week, it beat Inside Out.
Yeah, beat Inside Out.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Stop it! Jurassic World is dominant, and as Andrew pointed out, that's half a bill.
Monster.
Yeah,
I can't see what I did there.
It is $500 million where really, the true report card for movies these days is, which is international on what can play in theaters in New Delhi and Beijing the way that they would in Peoria.
It's 20 million away from $1 billion globally.
That's insane.
So by next couple days, it's going to hit $1 billion. All right.
Jesus Christ.
So my point is, can I tell them what's a theme in David's show?
Yeah, sure.
So there's a dinosaur theme in David's show. So if you're in Las Vegas, you need to go check it out and go check out the fact he's got people are excited for dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Is it time?
For real dinosaurs?
We've got Jack Horner, paleontologist, Museum of the Rockies. He's the consultant for the Jurassic Park films. You can actually see him in Jurassic World when they're in the raptor pen and they're all excited about the fact that Chris Pratt got them to sort of behave. He's one of the guys in the back there. He's got a project. We've talked about a TED talk about trying to clone or bring back a dinosaur basically by taking bird DNA and just devolving it, switching on the little parts of it that actually coded for dinosaur, not adding anything in there. I'm saying let's make something that looks like a dinosaur. We could take some bird DNA. We know what sequences cause muscularity. We can switch things off, make them grow bigger or whatever. It won't necessarily be a real dinosaur yet, but I think we can get there. And, you know, we might be able to get some dinosaur DNA if we try really hard. We found out that the half-life of dinosaur, of DNA in general, can be slowed down if there's iron present, which was a nice little thing in Jurassic World in the background. They mentioned that, like, well, we get it from amber, but also another source is, you know, the presence of iron to, you know, to blah, 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 which point is it time we do this?
Yeah. I mean, like, obviously, it's hard to do it on the back of the Jurassic Park and World films because there does not exist a place in which this happens where people don't get murdered by the dozens. But in general, of course, yes, why not? Why wouldn't we want to create new and fascinating creatures in general, let alone ones that have captured our imagination because they were the forebearers of the Earth?
Settled.
Done.
Done. Totally done. What could go wrong? I'm like, I think the bigger than Astri, because I think when the robots finally annihilate us, yeah, and wipe us out,
we need something to take them out.
Yeah, take them out, or at least like, hey, we had dinosaurs, you know.
Well, but all right. So what would, if we were playing, you know, dinosaurs? I was gonna say advocate, but you know, they would be rooting for them. If we were playing for non-dinosaurs advocate, what are the arguments against? Is it just that we're playing God and we shouldn't be bringing these things back, even though they're not really the things that existed? They're new things that we're creating to look and act like them.
The arguments against genetic engineering. There's gonna be the arguments against that we shouldn't be creating new forms of life.
But those aren't legit, are they? I mean,
they think they are. You got people who don't want us to eat GMO food, even though it saves millions and millions of lives. You know, I don't think that's a legit argument, you know? So
where do you think that comes from? Like where in our human brain do we say, like, we are what should be and nothing else should? Like, is it just because, you know, all news is local and we don't want to share or change, or we're afraid that we're going to screw something up? Is it that we as humanity don't trust ourselves with the future of the world?
We have a fear of things we don't understand and things that we that give us an adverse reaction. So if you have this idea that things that are genetically modified are not natural or whatever, then you're going to be like, oh, no, we shouldn't tinker. And then people will have this false idea of what, you know, that oh, if we live this perfectly healthy lifestyle, if we only eat wild things and natural things, we're going to live perfectly, you know, lives, which, you know.
Well, if they could take a birth defect from a baby before it was born, would that be screwing with the genetics of the child?
People who would say you shouldn't do that.
Yeah, man. There's a whole movie about how that screwed up called Gattaca, and we rooted for the people with, like, the heart defects.
Yeah, right. Well, Gattaca, yeah.
Yeah, and there are people who argue that's one of the big things.
Is Gattaca true?
Could be. Marge, this isn't Gattaca.
Right.
That's been a big thing. Like, right now, in our ability to alter DNA, is we have the ability, we can affect basically the germline DNA. We could get rid of certain birth defects and none of your descendants would ever have it. But people say, no, we don't want to do that. Some people are okay with altering it within this person, but we don't want to be able to affect their progeny. And so that's kind of the place we're at, where you get these bans against GMO stuff that aren't based on science. You know, more people died in the last 10 years from quote natural stuff that got, you know, infected with, you know, cholera or listeria or whatever stuff than anybody's ever been affected by a GMO food. But people just have this, ooh, Franken food and stuff. And it's,
yeah. Well, all right. It's easy for us to be talking about this on the podcast, though. But you mentioned something very interesting, which is that Chris has an extraordinarily unique and amazing position where he makes big scale entertainment not only happen, but also deals with all the nuts and bolts in making sure that miracles are seen by people who pay to see them. So Jurassic Park's gigantic. You mentioned that dinosaurs are a theme in David's show. Let's say because Jurassic World continues to make all the money in the world, now David comes to you, Chris, and says, hey, I want to build I want to fund a dinosaur theme park. Abu Dhabi billionaire came to the show and said, hey, this is something that I want to help back. I need your help to do it. Chris, you are now in charge.
David's like, I've got an island.
Yeah, he's got an island. He does have an island.
He doesn't have an island, right?
He's like, you know what would be great is when Zuckerberg visits if something chased him.
Yeah. So what is, in this hypothetical, like, what are your real world, I need to make this happen and yet, deal with any potential
problems? Funny thing is, the first thing I would do is call Andrew to find out if it was even remotely possible. Because I've seen the TED Talks and stuff. So, it seems like maybe some point they're going to do something pretty extraordinary. What? So that I think, I don't know if throwing money at them is really going to solve that problem. It might be time, but the money obviously is going to help. But I think, smart people need time sometimes. And that's,
I think if you have the money, like a big part of the Horner dinosaur thing, I think he's paying for part of it out of his own pocket. And I think that if we wave some money around, if we started an initiative, I think that if you drew it around, what could we realistically do? Like, well, we're going to tamper the hell out of bird DNA and try to create something. We're going to look at these things. You create a realistic, we want to create a hybrid that looks like this, has these features. It's a paycheck thing. It really comes down to
here, right now, why don't you just go to Kickstarter and say, if you bought a ticket to Jurassic World, donate $5 and we'll make some dinosaurs.
And so what do we do?
Can we, I would love to talk to just get a ballpark dollar figure from Horner on like what would move the needle on this process.
Is it $1 billion? Is it $2 billion?
That has to be written on a check to bring us not that all of a sudden dinosaurs show up next week, right?
Think about it. If he had a real solid thing, I think you could crowdfund it for sure. You could get $1 billion crowdfunded for dinosaurs. Well, I
mean, people give tens of millions for the Pebble 2, which in the grand scheme of life, no one will remember in 10 years, right?
The Pebble 2.
Yeah, when the Pebble 2 goes on your wrist, it doesn't eat you.
Yeah, I mean, but not to diss the Pebble 2 or anything, but it's like to be like, people feel like, oh my God, I felt like I'm part of history because I funded a Veronica Mars movie. Like, that's peanuts compared to I brought dinosaurs back.
So here's my question for y'all. Is part of what was great, if you go back and read the original Jurassic Park, it was cool. The idea that it's done in absolute secrecy, the way that it's told is that this is a thing that really happened. It was a great narrative device. You would kind of have to like not tell people. So if I was some crazy rich Saudi billionaire and I was trying to do this, I wouldn't tell anybody I was doing it right now. The reason being, look at the documentary Blackfish.
Yeah.
In the perception, because like you're going to get a lot of like dinosaurs that don't quite work at first, and you don't want that bad publicity. We're like, you're creating these poor monsters. Why are you doing this? We want to see the finished product. We don't want to see what goes into making these things.
Which is my favorite part of the book, Jurassic Park, that has no representation in any of the films, is the book opens with Hammond going looking for money, doing like a dog and pony roadshow, where he has in a cage like the first like alpha draft of a dinosaur that is this like kind of mangled sort of weird creature that looks enough like a dinosaur that you can believe the future is possible, but it's certainly not anywhere near where we eventually see the ready to open park after he has obviously secured the money.
Yeah, it's such a great book, guys. Go back and read that book.
Go read that book.
We have the full version on Audible, by the way. And I think Scott Brick does the narration.
Oh, that's great. So
all right. We voted. The problem is we got to figure out how to do this. And then we put it in the Kickstarter. And by the way, we're going to go dark for a couple years. So not share with you the abominations we create, because it's like white tigers. White tigers is not a breed of tiger. It's a defect. And so you'll see for every really beautiful white tiger you see, there is like a disfigured white tiger somewhere.
Oh, I'm not, that's so sad. I didn't like cats.
Yeah, I didn't mean to. Yeah, it was better than cats. So I didn't mean to tell that to everybody, but that's the truth about white tigers. It's not a breed.
Well, there we go. You learn one new depressing thing every day, folks. That's what they say on the Weird Things podcast.
True that. I sent you a couple items, Justin. Meanwhile, I want to tell everybody, take a look over at www.patreon.com. weirdthings.com/weirdthings. And if you want to support our little podcast here, it is greatly appreciated. And we can do things like pursue dinosaur DNA projects. We're going to be doing a test soon of a device that may put it to your temple. It may cause you to get more energetic or help you relax or whatever. And so some of the, I would call it science that we're doing, kind of the pseudoscience that, you know, we're doing. I mean, that thing could be real. I mean, our capabilities as scientists are suspect.
What I think you could charitably call citizen science, and
yes,
you could more accurately call sham science.
Yes, sham science on things that are probably are very real and scientific. So I sent you
By the way, people are coming back at you in the chat, Andrew, saying that that is not the truth about white tigers.
Okay.
I love that. I love the Andrew. Okay. I'm right and you're not. Okay.
No. I mean, okay. We could be a bigger debate.
We'll talk about that later.
We'll see. If anybody has anything else that they would like to bring up about the white tigers, we'll bring it back up. But I did just want to feed that to you. Patreon.com/weirdthings, of course, helps us employ the fabulous producer, Bryce Neshcom Castillo, who just had a birthday this week. Happy birthday to Bryce. He does so much for this show and so many others. So everybody go ahead and wish him a happy birthday at BRYCAS on Twitter. Bryce is
looking it up.
I'm happy to refer him to the resources, but they're Bengal tigers with a variant in the pigmentation there. It's if you have vitiligo or some disease that affects your pigmentation, you're not a special breed, folks. You're albino. You're different. No, you're human.
I am a ginger.
Yeah, and it's not technically albino.
And also Neshcom has put from bigcatrescue.org, all white tigers are inbred and not purebred. So, I think, the defense rests, Your Honor.
Yeah, that's the group there. They try and do their big focuses on just some of the damage that tiger breeding does and that. Trying to breed for these particular traits. They're beautiful animals. They're beautiful, majestic animals. But
hey, Andrew, it looks like you sent me something that we cracked the code here. We found the Holy Grail. We found a ghost.
Yeah. We may have to stop weird things. It's going to become normal things now.
Yeah, look at this. This comes from the Inquisitor. The headline reads, which hopefully somebody in the chat room can take this down and give the link there in the chat room. Is this a ghost? Hospital worker claims to have taken eerie picture of a ghost near a children's ward. And if I were to describe this picture, it is far down a hallway, and it looks like a ghostly apparition of possibly a little girl in a skirt walking toward a door. The story goes on to say, when you work the night shift, every noise and motion can be nerve-wracking, but it's even creepier if while you're at work, you see a ghost down the hall. Just before starting his night shift, Andrew Milburn, 21, was texting his girlfriend at Leeds General Infirmary on Friday night. He took a photo to prove that he was at work, according to the Metro. When he sent the picture to her, she noticed that there was a ghost in the hallway.
And that's the key thing, is they're like, they're really awesome. Like, oh my God, I shot a photo of a ghost. I'm not aware of any stories where, like, we saw the ghost and we took a photo of the ghost. It's always after the fact, you're looking at your photos going, oh, wait, does that look like a ghost?
Yeah, ghost you.
There's a ghost. Like, we got a ghost. I didn't see it. The ghost wasn't there when I, you know. So given all the different things that can happen with the camera, and Chris is quite the camera expert, by the way.
I don't know about that. I do have quite a few cameras here with me. Thanks.
You ever taken a photo of a ghost?
No, not that I know of. Maybe they're there, and I just don't see it. Mm. But the answer would be
taking a photo that's looked weird. That through photo artifacting, you're just like, oh man, that looks odd.
No, like, the weirdest picture I ever took was we were on the road in Paris, and I took a photo of the skyline out of the window. And this is before video, before digital, so I have to get it developed. So it get developed, and in the center of the picture was this silver, looked like a silver orb. This is why people have UFO pictures.
Yeah. Like
glowing silver orb. The problem is, it was very clearly a defect on the negative. I mean, like, you could look at the negative, and you saw the same, because when they developed it, there was another little same kind of imperfection on another photo, but it just didn't happen to be in the sky. It was a picture of, like, two people standing next to each other, and it was, you know, the same orb was on their shoulder.
That was a spirit, Chris.
So it was, you know, but it was, if I had just seen that and was insane and thought that UFOs were flying around, I would have gone, oh, you know, that's a UFO.
I think it was a spirit.
It could have been.
Yeah, I think
it could
have been. Spirit.
Well, and obviously the spirit was reaching out and affected the negative as well because of its power. I mean, like, that's a case
closed. Could be. Yeah, that could be.
Well, yeah, it's funny that you mentioned that because I almost feel that that the move from film to digital being the dominant way that people take photographs mean that any artifacting that happens in a digital photograph, it almost feels more legitimate that you are actually capturing a ghost because you are not dealing with somebody else handling your film. You're not dealing with a oftentimes two people mysterious development process if you have no idea how films develop. It seems to be a more accurate representation of reality, right?
Yeah, kind of. I would say that I look at a digital picture and
everything's suspect for me for that.
Yeah, everything's suspect in photos anyway, from what I've seen.
I'm not even sure we're here. I want to touch back to the dinosaur thing because there's something I left unfinished here.
That's all you talk about.
That's all I think about.
It's like that's all we past couple of days. I've heard a lot about dinosaurs.
All right. Well, yeah. Let's go. What else? What else have we left with the dinosaurs?
So I got a hypothetical for you.
Okay.
All right. I want to get your different answers to that. Okay. You get it, Justin. You get a call for me. I'm like, Justin, I need you to fly down here. I need you to fly down to Burbank.
Done. Okay. All right. I'm buying. I'm on United. I'm on the app. I'm buying a ticket, and I'll be down there by 9:00 p.m.
Okay. I take you to a Burbank warehouse, yep. Right? And I look like I haven't slept in months. You haven't heard from me. It's been sporadic and stuff. All you know is that, like, I liquidated all my assets, sold my house in Florida, all this. I've been on some crazy ambitious thing. I'm like, come with me.
Okay, for the record, none of that is weird. Like, you know, if Andrew liquidated all of his assets and I hadn't heard from him because he was working very diligently on something, that would barely register in my Andrew's gone out of control scale. Like, that's...
I've got, like, kind of beard growth and all this. We go to this dingy warehouse, open up the door, and you notice you walk in there and you see, like, these buckets of, like pig parts and food and whatever like this, okay?
All right.
Smells horrible, right? Just disgusting smell. It's this empty warehouse. It's, like, bales of hay and stuff like that. And then we walk around a corner and you see this office, you see this Home Depot chain link fence, right? And there's a velociraptor, but maybe not a huge one, but there's, like, a velociraptor, okay? And it's like, yeah. Ah, you know, clawing at it, going crazy, pacing back and forth, chewing up bones, really nasty looking at its face. And you see, like, a row of incubators and eggs and stuff. And I'm like, I found a guy. I figured it out. I made it.
You made a dinosaur.
Made a dinosaur. What's that?
In a Burbank warehouse, you have a dinosaur.
I tinkered with it, and he hates me, by the way. He will murder me if I go in there. It's not a pleasant thing. What do I do now? And, like, Chris, you get the same call, but you guys arrive at different times. I'm like, now what?
Well, I'm trying to figure out how we're going to make money on
this. Right?
Wait, hold on.
First, I want to know how the hell you did this. Like,
whoa. Let's before we go into the pseudoscience on how this this monstrosity was created, you are sure that you can't make, like, if you have a living velociraptor, that is something that you can't make money on?
I'm a little bit burnt out from the experience. I'm looking for advice. I'm not saying I can't. I'm just like, I've spent everything.
Genner said very, very sure that, well, this is something.
I'm trying to figure out how to pay rent on this thing, and I'm worried about animal control knocking on my door and how to feed this thing because it's hungry and I'm running out of money.
I mean, I feel like, listen, there are a lot. This is a tricky thing to try and navigate, but if you have created a velociraptor, you are attention away. Attention is the oxygen to your fire for you to become the most famous person in the world, right? The person who creates a dinosaur is the most famous person in the world.
But how do we do it? I'm asking for plans here, not you telling me what I need to be doing.
I'm just setting the stage. I think this is the best opportunity we've all ever had. This puts us in the history books. This is a legacy.
So what do we do? Do we put it on a tour? Do we create a little park? Do we do a state? Do we go to Vegas?
I mean,
Do we do King Kong? Do we do like put him on stage, you know, and then dancing girls come out there in the story of me, we get a better handsome young actor to play me in the creation of it. And then he comes out on stage in chains.
I mean, here's the first thing. We're going to have to, we're going to have to invent somebody else who did a lot of the dirty work on this, because otherwise you're never going to be able to show your face or explain how this was done. Like, you got to say you were just the lab assistant for a big psychopath.
And then you look over in the corner and you see the feet and legs of somebody like dead, you know, half eaten.
You get a bum. You get a bum. You let him eat him up.
Maybe somebody, maybe I had a helper who did get eaten.
Yeah, no, but
the homeless people in Burbank are now gone.
Jay Leno has a crazy story of being chased out of his car warehouse.
So, it was like a dog, but not a dog.
Yeah. So we got one kind of like, he's got hair, but he's kind of like Bill the Cat, you know, kind of looking velociraptor. Are we like, okay, let's get some investors and get this right before we tell everybody? Or like, let's just take this thing and, you know.
Well, the problem with that is, I think the second that too many people know, everybody knows.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't, even if you went and said, it's hard to keep something like that a secret.
Oh, I have a way to keep them a secret. I let them in the cage.
Well, also, another thing is that might not be that difficult to really keep a secret because it's such an outlandish story.
Oh, we're talking about animatronics. We're animatronics.
It's such an outlandish story that the people are going to have to see it to believe it. So unless someone has the video or a picture of it, you know, it's just be like, oh, yeah, right. I hear there's some guy doing this dinosaur.
Do we got to get this thing out of America? Like, because I feel like if we're going to keep this a secret, like, I don't know if you can keep that kind of secret.
I think Burbank, we slap a sign on the door that says Dinotronics.
Is Burbank robot. America? I mean, yeah, you could keep it out of Burbank.
Yeah.
I almost feel like we got it. Like, there's a reason why you know, InGen set up Jurassic Park out in a...
But once we're loading this, if we're taking this dude out of the country, once we put him on something, we got to go through border checks and all this sort of stuff.
Oh, no. Come on. You throw them in a tanker. Yeah, you throw them in one of those cans, right? You know, you just put them.
Pay for this.
Pay a stevedore to look the other way. The other way.
Chris is going to pay for this. Well, Chris, as soon as the show's over, I got to take you to a Burbank warehouse.
Is that where you've been the past 2 years?
Oh my gosh. I've got some theories now on how we can do this. So it's resolved.
Also,
we talked.
TikTok very, very correctly points out that Andrew, you what you have suggested is not a secret keeping measure. It is called murder. To just let people in the Velociraptor cage if they threaten to out.
Let's see what he does. I think he's friendly. Go check him out.
Yeah, I don't think you can try my Velociraptor in the court of law. Technically, he doesn't exist. No. I was at Sharon Stone took her boyfriend or her husband to go. She got him a special behind the scenes tour of the
San Francisco Zoo, the Komodo dragon, right?
Yes. You heard about this? Oh, he got bit. He got bit in the leg. And like, I think he lost the leg.
Yeah. Let me here. Go ahead and fill for a second.
Yeah. This is crazy. And like, I mean, like, that's like an awesome thing to go see. Like,
I sent you to the monkey jungle.
Oh, Justin and I went to the monkey jungle thanks to Chris, and we had monkeys crawling all over us. If I got rabies, I would have been okay with it. You know, I'd be like,
it was pretty, they're pretty awesome.
Those monkeys. Guys, awesome.
All right. So here we go. San Francisco Chronicle executive editor Phil Bronstein underwent foot surgery after being attacked by a Komodo dragon at the Los Angeles Zoo. Bronstein was on a private tour of the zoo Saturday when he entered in the Indonesian lizard's cage. Zookeeper asked him to remove his white tennis shoes to keep the 5-foot-long reptile from mistaking them for the white rats it was fed, Bronstein told the San Francisco Chronicle. The reptile attacked Bronson's shoeless foot, crushing his big toe while thrashing its body around, says Bronstein's wife, actress Sharon Stone, who witnessed the attack from outside the cage.
Awesome. This was like, how long ago was this?
This was June 10th. Awesome. I don't know what year, though.
Oh, it's like 10 years ago.
That's, yeah, it has back to be.
So Hey, happy birthday.
Yeah, that Komodo dragon's tasted blood.
If we wrote that as a plot for Basic Instinct 3, nobody would believe it.
Also, by the way, marrying Sharon Stone, I think probably the best any newspaper executive editor has ever done. So, you know, listen.
His family probably bought it and put him in charge. So, there you have it. So, yeah, it's a... How do you cover these things up? That's that. I mean, I wouldn't try to cover it. I'd be totally lawful and get my permits and do everything within the letter of the law.
By the way, this was June 23rd, 2001.
Wow.
A pre-9/11 world where we cared about the foot of Sharon Stone's husband.
Yeah.
It's big news.
Oh. Well, gentlemen. We want to move on to picks.
Sure. Do you guys? I got a pick. Do you guys have picks that you're itching to
go,
get at?
Go, you go first. You go first with your pick.
So I went and saw the new Pixar film Inside Out, and I very 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 much loved it. I was not. I guess Pixar has not had the most stellar record over the last few movies. I mean, at least by Pixar standards. Like, I never even went out and saw Brave, you know, because people were so sort of wishy-washy on it. You know, obviously Cars 2 was, you know, something that has not been very highly reviewed. But I did like Monsters, Inc. 2, but it was just...
I liked Monsters University. It was fun, yeah.
Yeah, no, I liked it. I liked it fine, but it is one of those things where for all that Pixar can do, it just is never quite as magical as when they do something so outside the box and so original that you're like, wow, nobody else could do this but Pixar. And this movie, Inside Out, is probably the first time I felt like that in a while with what they've done. It is really an extraordinary film in how easy it is to... how accessible it is. I mean, it is ostensibly a movie for kids, right? And yet there's so much there that's very plainly for an older crowd, and really a very philosophical movie. You know, it's a movie about creativity. It's a movie about why we are who we are, about how memories shape the lives that we lead, and how permanent and impermanent some of it is. There are things in the film that are just kind of glossed over, that if you're a kid watching it, you don't really take too much time. But without spoiling much, there are elements of the subconscious that are just getting bulldozed, you know, and they never really explain why they're getting bulldozed. But if you're watching the movie and you understand where it's coming from, it's about the maturation of the little girl whose head, you know, this is taking place inside of. And it doesn't, there's no moment where, beyond just the rules of the movie, which is a straight ahead, you know, we need to bring the artifact back to the temple to save the world kind of plot, that any, the rules of the movie are explained very, very clearly. But all the other stuff, all the kind of big question, why, you know, how are our personalities shaped, kind of questions and ruminations are just kind of there if you'd like it. I thought it was really, really, really well done. And it's one of those movies that you just thank, you know, you're just really happy that Pixar exists, because nobody else is going to do that movie that well.
Did you tear up during the end of this?
Constantly through the movie. I don't know.
I have a 5-year-old daughter. So 5.5-year-old daughter. So to think, you know, I don't want to screw this girl up, and you know, you watch that movie, and that's all you think of.
Yeah. Oh, amazing. Dude. Yeah. I can't imagine. I mean, for where, you know, you are in fatherhood, like, I can't. I wouldn't be able to watch. I mean, like, I'm a 32-year-old dude with no kids, and I cried. You know, I was just like, kind of choking back tears throughout the film. You know, so I can't imagine. You know, watching it with a small daughter.
Well, I didn't see it with her, but I have a small daughter. I mean, but I saw it with a very cynical person who doesn't cry at movies.
No, so, not me. Not me, by the way. No.
Says, but we go to the movie. I've never cried at a movie, just once, 1984. But then I, So it's kind of funny. But yeah, I'm just like weeping. Early on, I had tears in my eyes. It's like, holy
This is God. The Pixar logo.
Yeah, that's about right. I'm a sucker for
Pixar. Luxo can't balance on the ball. Oh, wait.
Speaking of this, was Lava in that? Did you see the pre-movie, Lava?
No, you want to know what? I actually I walked in after the movie had, like 2 minutes after the movie had started, so I didn't see the short film.
Okay. I need to see it again. I don't want to say I didn't like it, and I don't want to say I liked it. It's just, it's a little different. I think it's deeper than I actually am. I got to see it again. I got to see it again. Yeah.
He's a very small man, very limited imagination.
Yeah, oh, sure. Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I'll say this. With this movie, I feel like, I think Pete Docter was the director. Pete Docter, to me, this was kind of his coming out party as like this, you know, he is somebody for whom I want to see every movie that he does from here on out. Like, this was a movie on the level that I felt like when I saw Iron Giant, I'm like, Brad Bird, a name I want to remember because he has a great, you know, sense of creativity and execution.
And then give him a pass on a certain movie, you know?
Yeah. 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 You know,
so, I have a couple picks here.
We're all going to be in Tomorrowland soon.
Yes. After watching Jurassic World, guys, a little dino crazy here.
Are always dino crazy. Dino. Let's get that straight. He's always dino crazy.
I want to write a letter to Elon Musk. Dear Mr. Musk, I think spaceships are awesome. Right. You have other things you could do, too, for the world for dinosaurs. I went back and I watched the first three Jurassic Park films.
Mm-hmm.
And what was amazing to me was about watching the first Jurassic Park, and I probably watched it like a year ago, so it's not like it's been forever since I watched it. I laughed at the right points, you know, I enjoyed the right points. The first one. It's such a good film, such a good film, and it just reminds you of what makes Spielberg so awesome. You know, when Spielberg knocks it out of the park and takes a huge book, a very complicated book that is somebody who loves science. There's so many things I love about that book, but I know in a 2-hour movie, we don't get to those things. Let's just tell a good story that has intelligent scientists and people like that. I loved it. And what I loved about Jurassic World was Trevorrow made his own movie. You know, he made his own movie. He wasn't Spielberg. He didn't have Crichton helping write the screenplay. He made something different with fun moments. And he went more comedic than science-y or whatever. I watched Lost World.
Yeah, that's the fascinating thing about Jurassic Park, right, is because it is Spielberg kind of at his best, and yet Lost World is kind of Spielberg at his worst, right?
Yeah, it was. I remember at the time that, Crichton was writing the Lost World. There was a sort of rush to get the book done so they could have it for the next movie, and Crichton was working on it, and then Spielberg wanted to go in a very different direction with it. So there were a couple elements that were the same, but then my... And Lost World has characters I just wouldn't find in a Crichton novel. And like the worst villain in all of the Jurassic films is Nick Van Owen, Vince Vaughn's character in Lost World. He plays this sort of this Earth First guy who's presented as a hero, but you look at everything he does that causes destruction and havoc and stuff, freeing the dinosaurs so they get loose in the base camp, which tears apart the base camp, the satellite communications, so everybody has to trek and get murdered by velociraptors, and like no, everybody dies because of him, except for like two people. He brings the little baby T-Rex back to the RV, which brings the other T-Rexes there, which kills the other guy trying to save their lives. He takes the bullets out of the Timbo's gun, the hunter, when he's trying to stop the T-Rex from eating people. But he's never presented as the villain. But if you watch this, you go, wow.
He's Greenpeace.
Yeah, he's like the worst element of their Greenpeace. There's some great stuff. And then they have scary people. Yeah.
I know they do. I just meaning.
Yeah. But it was just like, you go like, he's like that worst kind of like, hey, let's kill off the population to save the animals kind of thing. It was just... Yeah. But it's funny. It's not acknowledged. Like, man, he is, of all the people in Jurassic Park, all of them, he's the worst. He's the worst one ever. But Lost World was just, as a movie, nobody loves it like Jurassic Park. Third one.
It's hard to come after that.
Yeah, but it's story-wise. Third one, I thought they did a smaller story.
That also was at a weird place for Spielberg, right? Like, there was a moment that Spielberg had a string of movies, and I can look them up, but like, There was that time in which we kind of thought like Spielberg's never coming back. Like Spielberg just kind of does crappy movies now.
He just puts his name on stuff.
Yeah. But then, you know, the third one, which was directed by Joe Johnston, I thought was the first real Joe Johnston film that I really liked. And then I loved when he did, you know, Captain America. But, you know, it's a solid movie. It doesn't have – all the actors in it are very good, accomplished actors. It doesn't have the feeling of, like, a bigger movie. William H. Macy's great in it. You know, you get the Spinosaurus, by the way, which is, like, the biggest land carnivore ever. And so you get that. That shows up there. And, you know, it's a clear – it's like from here to here to here. The reason that he gets – that, you know, Dr. Grant gets pulled into, you know, the Jurassic Park. You're like, okay, I see this, whatever. And now they're there and, you know. And it's cool because, like, at the very beginning, Dr. Grant, by the way, he has the Museum of the Rockies, which is Jack Horner's museum. So he's basically Jack Horner. So, showed you the photo of me pushing the T-Rex bone. Yes.
Yeah, just real quick, that Spielberg stretch was Lost World, Amistad, Saving Private Ryan, which was obviously great. Then he had AI, and it was, like, right up until, like, Minority Report. I remember, like, looking at the trailer for Minority Report and being like, man, I wonder if this is going to be good. And then it turned out to be good, and he kind of came back with that, Catch Me If You Can, which is odd.
I just watched last night Empire of the Sun.
Rules.
Young Christian Bale, you know, thinking you're watching this kid going, he's going to be Batman? You know? And great, great film. Great John Malkovich performance in there. Really, really about a, you know, it's what happens. He's a, if you've never seen Empire of the Sun, it's about a boy. He's a British kid living in Shanghai, never been to Britain. He grew up there with his family in this sort of the British enclave there. And the Japanese take over China, and they take over there. So he gets put into a prisoner of war camp. And, you know, what's it like to grow up? And it's based in part by J.G. Ballard, who wrote the original book. He will live with his parents in an internment camp there, but it's based partially on his experiences there. So it's a neat movie.
Talk about it on the other side. This is Spielberg's movies from 82 to 89. E.T., or no, sorry, 81, Raiders of the Lost Ark, E.T., Temple of Doom, The Color Purple, Empire of the Sun, Last Crusade.
It's a pretty proud pedigree there.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not bad.
It's a resume.
Yeah.
Hey, you can pick one of those as a resume.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's insane. And then he did Hook. Oops.
Gentlemen, it's been weird.
Thanks.
Cool. Now we'll do after things, which is a little bit of a advice for people being who are creative, and just a little thoughts. You know, we could talk about you know, hypotheticals, like what would you do if you're in Russia and the mob wanted you to do a show?
Oh, dear.
Let's and then we can start recording.
They'll tell us how we did.
Who's they?
The people listening live right now.
We're listening. We're done, right?
No, they're live right now.
Are they?
Oh, yeah.
We're good?
Yeah. Yeah, so.
I think we might have a bit of a drop-off because Tom Merritt just went live as a guest on Twit for the first time since he was fired.
Ah, well, that's going to be interesting.
Do, exporting...
Yeah, we'll do a. It doesn't have to be a long one.
Which, no, I don't, it doesn't matter to me.
It's not like we're in the greatest, happiest place on earth. We can literally see the swimming pool from here.
Yeah, we can see the swimming pool.
Hopping and skipping and jumping.
This is the Disneyland swimming pool. It's right outside the window.
Oh, nice. All right, here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to After Things. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
That's me.
And Mr. Chris Kenner.
That's me.
So I'm excited to have Chris here on the show because Chris is, he's been a friend of Justin and myself for quite some time. And
I've known you for
a little budding magician. And Chris is a very multi-talented guy. He does a lot of different things. He is TV producer, stage producer. He is a magician. He runs one of the most successful live entertainment brands ever. You know, the David Copperfield, he's executive producer of David Copperfield's show. I remember Chris way before all back then, he put out a book called
Out of Control.
Chris Kenner's Out of Control. And what it was a book of magic, of different kinds of magic, cards and coins and close-up stuff. And the magic in it was fantastic. The magic in it was just like out of somewhere, you know, out of nowhere, this guy, this crazy great thinker, put together the stuff there. But the way the book was presented was really hilarious, because it was, he had jokes in there, a lot of in jokes. He would, you know, the different descriptions of like the way you'd be looking at pictures and stuff, and they would change into.
Yeah.
It was like the Wicked Witch stuff.
It was kind of like if Mad Magazine meets a magic book.
Yeah, and he.
Old Mad Magazine.
He made fun of, like, there was he did the Michael Amar. Do you remember the Elvis stamp?
Yeah.
He did like a version of the Michael Amar stamp, and it was like before and after, like with his hair and without hair.
Funny now, because I don't have any hair.
Michael Amar is it was an amazing sort of thing to see. You could read this and you could see that this is a guy that has talents that go beyond just playing with a deck of cards. This is a guy that thought about a lot of different aspects.
And just to again give a primer to people who are not familiar with magic, you might think, oh, somebody does a magic book, that's funny, that's cool. Although, you know, there's a lot of things that are funny. In magic, that's not the case. There are like five actually funny people in the entire industry of magic. Like, you know, and we could probably name them right here on the show. Kenner is certainly one of them. And, you know, what has always been remarkable to me about your life, Chris, is that, you know, there have been so many turning points in magic since I have, followed it with iTrix. And you have always kind of found yourself sort of at the center of it with Out of Control. It was certainly, you know, in a boom for magic publishing with your role in Copperfield's organization to do magic as big as it has ever been done and have a longevity for which is so rarely, rarely seen, especially at the level that you guys are. And to partner, especially early on with, JB and Theory 11 and really kind of revolutionize the brand.
Founder of Theory 11. So one of the things that's amazing too about Out of Control is in there, I remember I have my copy and I remember somebody telling me, oh, you got to get this. There's this cut. There's this crazy cut. And it was this thing called Sybil, right? You know, named from, you know, it was a Sally Fields movie, yeah. The book, right? And it's this crazy thing where you take a deck of cards, half parts goes here, here, here. And the next thing you know, it's like goes in all these different directions. And it was insane. It was this card flourish that nobody really talked about those things. No serious magician ever put those things into books, to my recollection at that point. And out of nowhere comes this guy who's got really hardcore card chops, coin chops. He created an effect called three fly. If you watch a magician and he's got three coins in his hand, this guy invented that trick. He invented the trick that was the nucleus for that everybody else went from. Then he put this card thing called Sybil, which, if you look up cardistry now, the term cardistry, everybody who does it now, who knows the history of it, they trace it back. They go, well, it started with Sybil. It started with this thing that he did.
Yeah, and 30
years ago. 30 years ago. And he can do every single move those kids do today.
No, I can't. I wish I could. These kids are taking this stuff to a level beyond I could have possibly dreamed of. And there are 16-year-old kids that have skill that you cannot believe. You just look up cardistry online. It's unbelievable. And they are all so talented. I'm like,
really, it became so gigantic that it's really its own genre now. Like,
oh, yeah.
Its own thing for sure. It's by far its own thing. And there's a couple of like key people in it, you know, and they're like, you know, there's Andre Gide, Dan and Dave. Mm-hmm. Oh, there's a kid, Oliver Sarsgaard in overseas in Europe. That's unbelievable. He's young, really young. I'm not sure how old he is, but he's 18, 19, 17. Ridiculous.
At the latest Academy of Magical Arts Award dinner, they did a fun presentation with the Buck Twins and then Steve Valentine, and they did this thing like the Devil Goes Down to Georgia, and they did this thing with card stuff. But they came out on stage and they said, it started with Sybil. It started this thing. And my point to getting to this point, okay, is not because I'm going to try to make you buy dinner.
He just bought lunch.
Yeah. A lot of us are out there, we're trying to do things. We're writers, we're comedians, we're podcasters, we're doing these creative sorts of things. We're trying to figure out what our thing is. We're trying to figure out what's the thing that we need to be doing. What is the plan that we're going to fit into in life? And if I looked at Out of Control, I'd go like, oh, well, this guy's going to be, you know, he's funny. He's going to be one of the top close-up magicians in the world, or he's going to be a guy who's going to be known in magic conventions, or he's going to keep writing books, or maybe he's going to go to Hollywood and write for sitcoms or something like that, or do something like that. You found a path and created a path for you that's incredible. How did you, when did you feel like, oh, this is what I'm supposed to be doing? Or have you got there yet?
I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. One thing that I do, and it's also similar to David, and my whole life, you know, David says this too, so it's kind of funny that we both kind of have a similar feeling, David Copperfield. I don't take no for an answer. A lot of people say, oh, you can't do that. That trick's too hard. You can't do that. That affects too big. There's no way you're going to be able to do that. That doesn't work. And you just prove people wrong, and you do it. You just don't take no for an answer, and you do it. When I started to work for David, I've worked for David for 25 years this year. You know, I think it's August 8th. Who's counting? And it's
6 p.m.
Right.
22. 6,
yeah. It's probably 11 p.m. So, you know, David is constantly told, no, you can't do this trick. You can't do this spec. You won't fit in the building. You won't fit in this. You won't be able to do this. It's going to cost too much money. It's going to do this. And when I started to work for David, I got that resistance from my friends even. You know, you're not going to be able to work for him. It's too difficult. Just work there for a few weeks. You do this, do that. And I just was like, I'm going to make my own path. And that's what I kind of do with everything. I make my own way. There's a road. I don't even know if there's a road. I'm building the road in front of me. You know, I'm just building it. And if I get to a clearing and I can coast for a while before I have to build some more road, then that is what it is. But I know that's kind of metaphoric, but it is basically what I've done.
Well, you're
I've just gone straight, done what I want to do. I'm basically doing what I want to do. And I always have.
And I think that really has to be part of your spark for being in so many growth industries, like, you know, to have hit upon with Sybil, you know, the gigantic cardistry boom, with online retail, with Theory 11, what you guys have done with, a totally out of control, you know, you've happened to find yourself uniquely, especially in magic, to have not only one field for which you've been able to grow and expand a lot of these properties and make things far bigger than you started, but in multiple fields. You know, does it just go back to that one idea that, you know, whatever, we're just going to go ahead and do it and see where it goes?
No, I think it's, for me, it's always trying to progress. I always try to move forward. I very rarely go look backwards at my life. So I know so many people, creative people, and they'll have a great creative thought. These are guys, let's say I'll use magic as an example. A magician that's got these, they're supposed to be super creative. Yeah. Everybody goes, this guy's so creative. And then you really look at what they've done. They did two or three things when they were younger, and then they didn't really do much after. And they really live off of that for the rest of their life. He's the guy that did this. He's the guy that did that. He's the guy that did this. And they never kind of push themselves past that point. Because they could live off of that and be kind of famous in their own little world with that. And I give up on Three Fly. I give up on Sybil. I mean, I wanted to go to the next thing. It wasn't going to be like, look what I did. This was what I made. I'm that guy.
That was the thing, like, was there about Steve Jobs, is like, he didn't want to have like an Apple museum at Apple. He didn't want to have like, he didn't care like, oh, should we keep these companies? Like, no, he was always focused on the future. He wasn't a nostalgic guy.
Yeah, I'm not at all, and I don't keep things from my past. I go straight to the next thing, and I'm always worrying, trying to come up with the next thing that's good for me, that fits me, it's fun for me. It's got to be fun for me too.
Well, you know, one of the things about you that we hear the legendary sort of stories about stuff, and then it kind of like you sort of go like, man, what quality is this person that I don't know if I have? And you talk about not taking no, but it's the resourcefulness. And you had a great story about trying to find a ring.
Oh, yeah. This is David, the guy, and I can get things. If I need get an object, get something from one place to another place, find things that aren't sold anymore. I just have a knack for this kind of stuff. Well, we were in Oslo, Norway. Is that right? Oslo, Norway. And yeah. It was a holiday, and it was a Sunday, and everything was closed. Everything. And we're dark. We're going to open the show the next day. And David wanted these finger rings. We wanted very simple, not expensive, because we were just going to use it kind of like costume jewelry, because we're going to try them. We're going to destroy them. We needed like four or five of the same rings. So he said, I need them. I want to get them tonight. So he said it to us the night before. And I said, okay. And then I started asking, and I realized, holy cow, everything's closed right now. Everything's closed tomorrow. Everything's closed. So I start calling the promoter of the show, see if he knows anyone in a jewelry store, if anyone works in any kind of store that would have anything, you know, anything. We're asking everybody in town. And basically, I kind of said, hey, I'm not sure I'm going to have these things. So I haven't found a resource. Everything's closed. It's a Sunday. It's a holiday. And this is back in like the 90s. So it wasn't like nowadays. Europe is much more westernized and you can get anything anytime, pretty much.
Yeah.
So David looks at me and just says, without even thinking, it's like in the next, as I finish, I'm having a hard time. He says, have you gone to the airport, to the terminal for, what's it when you buy international, what's it called? When you fly international, there's the one area that you can buy duty free. Yeah. Because if you go into the duty free area at the airport, because any international airport's got a duty free area. So I'm like, and I just, this is prior to 9/11, so you can still get into the airports and just walk around. So I'm like, oh, I can't believe I didn't think of that. Holy cow. No, I didn't. And of course I went there and that's where we got them because we could find them. Blew my mind that day because I thought, just when I thought, it's one of those times when you think you're smart or you think you know how to do something, you think you're good at something, and then you kind of exhaust your resources, exhaust your ideas, and then someone just goes, oh, just try that. And it's the very first thing off the top of their head. It's pretty humbling. And I remember that story very well. And it, you know, I always think of that story when I can't find something or I need to do something or I need to get something done. Because no way do I want to go to David Copperfield and say, I can't do that.
Well,
unless I know for sure, or I have a very good reason for it.
And you just related it out, you know, now how that affects you, like trying to get a microphone cable.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm going to get it.
Can you tell them the story? I mean, that just,
not really.
Okay.
I don't really want to tell this story.
No worries. Sorry. All right. But
that is an amazing, trait though, and it is something that I see with my most successful friends, and I try to emulate is it creativity is so often, I think, clearing the dead wood like from your consciousness. And for, like, you know, David came up with that idea for the duty free shop because in his head he hadn't been racking his brain about, oh, where do I find finger rings? Should I call somebody local? Should I try to see if I can find the owner of a shop so they
I gave him the list of the things I had done. Right.
Yeah. And well, so being able to clear it and say, okay, all these dead ends that I'm hitting are in part because I've walked down these paths. I made conscious decisions to say, I'm going to try to solve these things this way. And if you are free of that context, so often you can just have, okay, let me think of this whole nother way to solve it. And the most successful people I know are people who are able to do it themselves, who are able to kind of clear the deck and say, okay, how about we look at it this way? How about we stop thinking about it in a way that has given context to this problem before?
Well, both you, Justin, and Chris have both solved similar problems where you've gone to, like, go to Twitter and say, anybody in this town can do this or whatever. Like you do with the Go game and needing actors and people like that.
Yeah, I do that all the time. If I need to get something, I'll go to Twitter and ask people.
And it's a tremendous resource, you know, and
people answer, and it's unbelievable. Twitter is unbelievable. Actually, so Facebook's kind of like that, but Twitter is really powerful.
And that's for everybody out there, is to think about this. You think about your resources, and the resources aren't necessarily what, you know, money you have, but it can be people you know or networks that you are. What networks are you part of that you can then ask? Because there are going to be people who want to help you solve your problem. There very often will. And you may not have an answer, but if you can put it out there and say, how do I do X? Somebody, you know, 1 out of 10 people, one person sitting around bored and might go, man, I want to figure out how to do this, and I will help you with that. And so learn to use those things. And there's you're going to be very, very close resources to your friends you go to. And I do that all the time. I go to people like, I'm at a dead end. How do I do this? And then people will reframe it. Sometimes you need to think bigger, you know, think bigger about it. Might say, well, if money is no object, how would I do it? And like, well, now that I know, then you might have an answer, but then you say, you know what? What if now that I know there's that option, how do I do it without the money? How do I make that happen? And think bigger, think differently, and then just ask people. I mean, don't ask people to do everything for you, but.
Oh no. I mean,
it's always good to know your limitations into what you need to ask for. Yeah. That's another, I think that's a problem that a lot of creative people have, is that they think that they have to do it themselves. And at some point you go, I'm not really sure. Let's say you're not technical. You don't know computers or you don't know whatever it is. It's not a problem to ask someone to help you make something or help you get something done. Mm-hmm. It's not against the rules. You don't have to do it every single thing yourself.
We actually just found out in the chat room, we have a wild on his own power and probably having drank since 10 o'clock this morning, Brian Brushwood has just thundered into the chat room. So let me see if he has any.
Thundered like a dinosaur into the chat room, like some sauropod. It's sort of on some sort of a rampage here. So about this dinosaur thing.
Yeah.
I think I can get this thing back.
I think we can get it funded.
Yeah.
David is pretty brilliant.
But you know, and just to add on to that final point, I've always wanted to ask people as many questions as possible, you know, and there's such a tremendous perspective to kind of understanding that like your brain can only produce so many solutions and your brain gets better every time you understand how other people solve problems, that it's always one of those things that, like, even if I think I have a good idea, if I think I have a solution, I want to ask somebody else about how they would want to do it. And yeah, I think I've told this to, I don't know if I've told it on Weird Things before, but my buddy Nick Gerwich, we used to work at the same newspaper together, who wrote then and writes now the Perry Bible Fellowship, is one of the most creative and amazing artists and people that I've ever met. He used to do edit art for the newspaper, and he was great. I mean, this guy is, you know, one of the, you know, an amazing comedic mind and a great artist. And he would show me the edit art and he would say, like, hey, what do you think? And I would say, oh, that's cool. Or he'd say, hey, I got this idea. I'm halfway through. What do you think should happen after that? And I would give him an idea and I'd say, oh, okay, I think it'd be funny if this guy did this or you had this show up there. And he would always say, like, uh-huh. Oh, wow. That's good. That's really good. And then would never take my advice ever. Right. It would always be different than what he initially said he wanted to do, and yet never what I had suggested. And I think beyond just, you know, him thinking that my ideas were dumb, that part of it was his process of wanting to go to people and understand where they thought it should go so he could get a better idea on, you know, bringing the joke forward or bringing the point forward and making it clearer and more understandable. And that's something that I've always taken with me, that, you know, you can always use more perspective, even if you think you know for sure what you're going to do is the right thing.
Well, it's not about, sometimes I think with the creative process and doing something that's creative and trying to break, you know, ground, you have to follow what you feel no matter what. And again, I'll bring David up in this. David, we're in the middle of a trick right now, an illusion that requires something that we're fighting with. Sometimes the audience doesn't like it. Sometimes the audience loves it. It's a really a polar thing. It's a love and hate kind of thing.
It's called killing a puppy.
Yes, no. And David really is fighting for a part of it to stay in, and he wants to make it work. So there's something to be said for taking your idea that you love, like, oh, I really want this. I really want this to work. I really want this to work, and just doing it. You know, you look at the fashion industry. Man, those guys are crazy, and they're bold, and they try things, and when it hits, it hits. When it doesn't, it kind of sometimes just goes away into the noise. So it's the noise. They don't care about the noise. They don't mind making 20 mistakes and then have one giant hit. That's what puts them on the, you know, that's what makes them really different, makes them creative. So it's stick with your idea sometimes too. You know, don't.
I'm a believer, like, when you ask for advice, listen to advice. And when you encounter bad advice, at least think about it, understand where it came from. And don't just, because sometimes the best things are the things we don't do, we think is bad advice, and then you go back and you go, oh, man, no, this is what they meant.
Yeah.
Well, smart. Here's the thing about bad advice. If you're going to dismiss bad advice, you better be able to understand exactly why it's bad and exactly where you can think of, like, why that didn't work, you know? Like, I feel like if you don't have context to it, if you're just dismissing it out of hand for whatever reason, that's where you get yourself in trouble. Like, bad advice.
Here's a bad advice thing. I'm sorry to interrupt, but this is a bad advice thing that we get, as in getting advice from people and responses from audience members of the show. Sometimes you will have a strong opinion that something is correct, and your really strong opinion about it. And then the audience might say more times than you want the same exact, we'll call it bad advice, because you know in your heart you couldn't do it that way. If you did it that way, it wouldn't work. And we've even some of the times we've tried it that way and it hasn't worked. But you keep getting that advice. So you have to sometimes it's not telling you that to do it their way, like it's the bad advice, but that your way might still not be perfect.
Yeah.
So it's the fact that they want to give you such a strong opinion tells you something. That's really what I'm trying to say.
That something's wrong.
Right. It doesn't necessarily mean they're correct or that you're correct. It's just something is a foot.
Well, you guys have a very interesting process too in how you work on stuff.
Yeah, we're different than most.
Can you talk about that or?
Well, it's all different. Depends on like what do you mean? Like you
like,
kind of know.
Asking audiences.
Oh yeah, we ask audience members. We always ask people. We will test a trick prior to putting it in the show. Like myself will go out so David can watch it. And let's say that we have a trick that's new, and it's a speaking trick with an effect in it. And it's not where somebody comes out and produces a car. It's a little more cerebral trick. I may learn the trick and go out and perform it for a small group of people after a show. We'd pull back 100 audience members. I'd do the trick so David can watch it.
Yeah.
And I would basically try to learn it almost for a script, word for word. And then one of the theories is if I can get it to work, it shouldn't be any problem for David to get it to work. Because if they're going to sit and listen to me for 5 minutes or 8 minutes, they'll definitely listen to David Copperfield for 5 or 8 minutes. So, you know, we kind of can hash out lines and things with it. And then we throw David in and he tries it and he does it and he sees what works and what doesn't work. And that's an interesting process. But to get to that point, you know, you have to have a lot of confidence in it. We do a lot of things that are definitely not normal.
We talk, you know, a theme on this podcast is you want to have a process to become better. You want to have a process to make things better. And a lot of times people put things out in the world like, I did wrote a book. I made a movie. I wrote a song. I did this. Or I do a podcast. Like, great.
I'm always working.
Yeah, but like, but what is your process to get better? How do you, you know, it's not just keep doing it. How do you analyze? How do you do that? And that's what I love about what you guys do is that nobody does that. Nobody does that. And that's why it's the most successful. He's the most successful magician in history, because you guys take the time to say, no, let's test this in front of audiences and let's see how people react to this. And then we'll decide what we need to tweak or how to adjust and not just put it on stage right away and then go,
I have a problem with people that say, oh, we do classic magic tricks. Do the classic trick of such and such. You know, and I look at it like this. If let's say that John Smith creates the Miracle Magic book trick, and it's a classic trick that all magicians do, the Miracle Magic book trick. And then no one changes it, no one does anything, but it feels outdated, probably because if John Smith, who was so smart and created the trick at the beginning, were alive today, he would have altered it to fit today. It was created in 1950 to fit 1950 and 1950s audiences. So you have to kind of really look at things when you try to do a classic thing or something that's been done before. You have to like it's a different world. It's a totally different animal right now.
Well, and what I think your process demonstrates just a craft that is, I think, common amongst the most successful creative people that we've seen in pop culture and is uncommon in magic, quite frankly. You know, there's a lot.
It's easy to be creative in magic, yes.
Well, just in terms of the craft stuff, in terms of working on it, in terms of being creative, in terms of putting out new and original ideas and never being satisfied, you know, to kind of just sit on something. I mean, there's, you know, the Copperfield show is unique because there is a level of fame that David has that theoretically you could just do, you know, scale appropriate approximations of the biggest things that people remember on television. And that show would run for a very healthy time for Vegas and around the world, you know, because people will just remember that those things worked for a reason and that could just be it. But you guys don't stop there because there is a commitment.
We go forward.
Yeah. And well, only in magic, that's not so off. You know, a lot of times, like you said, it's the one thing that happened when, you know, at a very young age that you're just going to ride that horse until the legs fall off.
There's the picture for it. Gentlemen, I think this has been a good after things.
Yeah, good times.
Thank you, Mr. Kinner, for being here.
Yeah, thanks, Chris.
Too young.
All I know is we're going to make dinosaurs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've learned that today. Actually, that's all I hear about from Andrew. That's all he talks about. It's been a while. It's not just – it's funny is now that Jurassic World is out, I'm realizing just how much he actually talks about dinosaurs, not just because of this movie. It's coming back to me. All these times are flashing in my head. Since you were a kid, you've been talking about dinosaurs. So
I have a dream, guys.
Yeah. I feel real short in this. I'm not really that short, but I'm like behind you.
Yeah. I think Andrew just knows how to do webcam posture.
Oh, yeah. He's like, hey, how's it going, guys?
It's been after.
Effects.
Here we go.
Awesome.
All right, guys. Well, I don't want to, you know, I'm sure you're there at Disneyland. You can go have a Disneyland time, I guess. Adios. See you guys.
Hey, are you, Justin, are you around tomorrow, manana, like 9 a.m. or so for me to give you a call? Or?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Tomorrow.
Are you up late tonight?
Yeah, 9 o'clock.
Are you up late tonight? Or?
Yeah, should be.
Okay, I'll text you.
Give me a call.
I got a conference call thing I got to get your opinion on.
Sweet.
All right. Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye, sir.